The Javelin missile has transformed the war in Ukraine. Here to discuss it today is Mr. Tom Heber. Tom developed systems for neutralizing rockets and drones. He currently coaches teenager robotics teams. Tom was undergraduate at MIT. Good morning, Tom.
Hey, Dr. Liu, how are you?
I'm really good. Thank you. And it's great to have you back.
Glad to be here. So today we're going to talk about the FGM-148 Javelin missile. It's been used with great success in Ukraine and elsewhere. And we'll talk about its operation, a little bit about its history, and a bit about its effectiveness. And this missile is a DARPA success story. This program started in DARPA, which is the Defense Advanced Research Project Agency. This is the launch tube with the soldier holding it. And you can see that it's a recoilless launch because the flame that comes out the back end is generated by a launch motor that burns entirely while it's inside the tube. So it's basically stopped burning out here so that the soldier doesn't get backblast from the missile, so that he can launch it safely, even from inside a room without getting harmed. And then later on, the flight motor will come on. So this is the Javelin missile. It's in production by Lockheed Martin. It's 5 inches in diameter. It's about 43 inches long, weighs about 35 pounds, and it has a range of over 4,000 meters. And the cost is, for just the missile, is about $175,000 per missile. And very briefly, up here is the Seeker Dome. So the Seeker, which is an infrared camera, is right behind it. These are the warhead initiation mechanisms. They get initiated from the rear. This is the Bane warhead right here. This is the electronic safe and arm and fusing function. That ensures that the missile doesn't go off until after it's been launched and is well away from the launch unit. And then in here is the launch motor. And then this is the flight motor, which is the main motor for propulsion. And that's what gets it going out to long distances. This is the site. It's called the Command and Launch Unit, or CLU, by Raytheon. It is an imaging infrared system, this being the large infrared lens. There's also a daylight camera up here. And the cost with the launch tube itself, this part, is about $75,000. So just as an example, if you order a bunch of missiles and not as many clues, the average price would be about $200,000. So when we appropriate $1 billion, that would come out to 5,000 missiles, which sounds like a lot, and it is. As you may know, President Zelensky has said that he needs 500 of these Javelins per day, which means that 5,000 missiles is 10 days supply. So that's what $1 billion buys in these missiles. They're pretty expensive.
The target of the missile could be much cheaper than itself, right? So the war is very expensive. I don't know what's the cost of averagely or a Russian tank.
Well, it's a little bit hard to compute because Russia has a different economic system than we do. But our tanks cost in excess of $10 million. Russian tanks are generally a little bit cheaper than that, but they're certainly going to cost millions of dollars. So if you can take out a $4 or $5 million tank with a $200,000 missile, even if it takes a couple of them, that's an economic success. But that isn't actually the point. The real point is you're stopping the tank or whatever it is from doing its mission. And so you're winning the war. That's really what the valuation that has to be placed on this missile or any other weapon system. If it allows you to win the war, then it's paid for itself.
I agree.
One of the things that's unique about the Javelin missile is that it can fire a so-called line of sight trajectory that goes straight to whatever the target is, just like any other missile, or it can follow a lofted trajectory where it flies up high to about 500 feet and then dives in on the target at the end. And this provides two advantages. First of all, the roof of the target is generally a much bigger target than the frontal area of the target, and it's much less well armored. But the second advantage is that in Soviet tanks, Russian tanks, the ammunition is generally located down here along the floor. So if you're shooting straight like this, usually, unless you can get the shot way down here, you don't hit the ammunition. But with a lofted flight, you quite often do. And then the ammunition is struck by the jet from the shape charge, which I'll get into that in a little bit. It usually detonates. And that's why you see tanks with their turrets blown off lying around in Ukraine.
The fly of a Javelin missile, I saw a curvable shot. Is that some technique very basic or just very hard to...
It is very basic. I'll show you why it looks that way. So if you remember, in the missile, you have the launch motor, and then you have the flight motor. And the launch motor fires while the missile is entirely inside the tube, and then it stops, because if the motor is still firing, it's going to blast the gunner, and you can't have that, you know, it would kill him. So it has to be extinguished before it gets out of the tube. And you can see this is the fire from the launch motor here. So because the launch motor stops and then the flight motor can't come on while it would impinge on the gunner. So it has to come on when the missile is well downrange, 20, 30 meters downrange. So as a result, there's no power to the missile from the time it leaves the tube until it's 20 or 30 meters downrange. So what that means is that the missile is going to start to fall before the flight motor comes on. So the missile has to be launched somewhat upward in the air, just as is shown here. So it goes up a little bit. So if I'll go back to this one. So this, what I've shown as a line of sight trajectory, isn't quite right, in fact. So what the missile does is at first, it has to launch a little bit up, but then it falls.
Yeah.
And then about here, the flight motor comes on. And then it either assumes, and it still has to go up a little bit to recover because it's falling. But then it's going to either follow more or less a line of sight trajectory, or it's going to go up and have the lofted top attack trajectory. So it will always be launched on a slightly upward trajectory, and then it will fall, and then it will reassume a slightly lofted trajectory until it decides on one that's mostly this way or mostly off. So how did we get this weapon in the first place? Well, it was really the brainchild of Dr. James, we call him Jim Tignaglia. He had come from the Army Night Vision Lab where he was working on infrared focal plane arrays. And they were thinking of using them principally as target detection mechanisms and maybe as sights for guns. But he had the idea of using the infrared focal plane array, which sees the heat image of a target or a scene. He thought of using them as missile seekers. And so he initiated a competition under the name Tank Breaker. That was the original name of the program back around 1979 to see whether it was possible to use infrared focal plane arrays as missile seekers. Now you have to remember, in 1979, image processing would barely existed in it. So a lot of people doubted that it could be done successfully. But he actually got four contractors to bid on the contract, and two of them were moderately successful with their missile and did end-to-end testing. So it so happened that around the same time, 1984 or three, thereabouts, the Army had its own anti-tank missile program stood up, which was called Advanced Anti-Armor Weapon System Medium. It's not the heavy missile, but the medium shoulder-fired missile. And they had their own preferred solutions, which were a laser beam rider, where the operator of the missile shines a laser beam on the target, and then the missile basically follows the laser beam all the way to the target, and a fiber optic guided missile. Now, the problem with both of these is that they are pretty much limited to line of sight, straight trajectories like this one up here. Whereas with the infrared fire and forget seeker, you can have top attack, but you also get another huge advantage, which is that with these, with your beam rider and the fiber optic, the gunner has to keep looking at the target for the entire time of flight of the missile, which can be 30 seconds or more. And so if the tank target sees the gunner or sees the missile, it can shoot back at him. And then if he ducks or flinches, then the missile goes off course and it doesn't hit. Whereas with the fire and forget missile, the gunner can immediately take cover as soon as he fires the missile, and it doesn't matter to the missile. The missile is on its own. So the Army didn't like that concept. They said, well, you fire and the missile forgets. But they were forced into a competition, and it turned out that the tank breaker missile won. So it became the official AUSM competitor, and it got full-scale development award in 1989, and that went to a combination of Texas Instruments and Martin Marietta. So that's how the missile got started, and it's all due to this man right here, Jim Tignaglia, who incidentally was also the father of a number of other important Army systems. He is really a giant in the field, and it's all due to DARPA. It's really an amazing thing. So we start with the hollow charge principle, which in this country is called the Monroe Effect, named after Charles Monroe from the Naval Torpedo Station. And this effect had generally been known for about a century, but it hadn't been applied by the military. So he demonstrated convincingly that a hollow charge has more penetration capability than a solid explosive charge. So they have a bottle-shaped piece of explosive right here, and this is just a big chunk of steel. So if you just detonate this plain flat bottom bottle, you get a small crater like this. And then they found, and this is the important part, that if you put a metal liner inside the hollowed out part, you got a much deeper hole in the steel. So that's the genesis of the so-called shaped charge. And in fact, modern shaped charges can penetrate 10 times their diameter into steel, which means that a 4-inch diameter warhead can penetrate over a meter of solid steel. So think about that. And it's a very simple thing. You know, anyone can make it, and many people have. Even small shaped charges could penetrate any tank in the world. In fact, just a 2-inch shaped charge like the US bazooka, or a 3-inch shaped charge like the Russian RPG, they could go through the armor of any tank in the world. So you could make very small anti-tank weapons like the bazooka and like the RPG. So for many years, that was the way it was. The tanks couldn't really do anything about these small anti-tank weapons. But then, in the late 70s, people discovered and improved reactive armor. And that disrupts the jet because it wipes along the jet. And so what comes out the back is a bunch of disrupted particles that have much less penetration power. So now the steel that was originally perforated by the shaped charge jet only gets dented by the small fragments that are left after the explosive reactive armor has detonated. And so you'll see this on the Russian tanks that have gone into Ukraine. It's going to be very difficult for an anti-tank weapon to hit any surface that isn't protected by reactive armor. However, Javelin does two things to overcome that. Well, three things, really. So first of all, Javelin doesn't come in straight in this direction. It comes in from the top. So even if it hits these reactive armor plates, they're not flying at an angle to the jet. They're flying along the jet. So once they become perforated by the jet, they no longer interact with it. So the jet from the warhead is much more effective. But also, Javelin will generally hit up in this area on top, which is not protected by reactive armor, because that's where the hatches for the gunner are, and some of the electronics and the sights and things like that, that you really can't put armor over. So that's the real secret. And this area, the whole total top area of the tank is much bigger than the side area. So it's difficult for it to hide. So that's why Javelin is so much more effective. What have the Russians tried to do about this? Well, they put some improvised countermeasures over the top that is trying to do two things. First of all, to change the signature so that the missile would become confused. If it flies in from here, it won't look like what it thinks a tank should look like. And also, if the missile comes in and hits up here, then it will detonate from a little bit farther away, and they hope that maybe that will keep it from being effective. So the question is, have these countermeasures worked? Well, here's what the Kiev Independent has to say about that. They claim that as of the 27th of March, that they've been able to kill 582 Russian tanks, some helicopters and planes. Now, those weren't all with Javelin. Some of those were with Stingers, but these were not with Stingers. These were mostly Javelins and some other anti-tank weapons. The Javelin is a very effective weapon, even against modern tanks, and that it's been used with great success in Ukraine, and that we may have entered an unexpected area of warfare. Vladimir Putin expected his armor forces would be able to just operate with impunity against the lightly armored forces of Ukraine, and it appears that that was unfounded. So the Javelin missile is a large part of that success story in Ukraine. We owe that to DARPA.
Thank you for your time and for the excellent expertise.